his contribution. I will earn the help
I need in advance by helping other people now and repay the help I receive by serving others later.
Thought to go with that this morning. Years ago, a young woman went into a rural area as a school teacher. Among those in her class was a girl who had failed before and who was failing again. The student could not read. She came from a family without the means to take her to a larger city for examination to determine whether she had a problem that could be remedied. Sensing that the difficulty might be with the girl's eyes, the young teacher, at her own expense, arranged to take the student to have her eyes tested. A deficiency was discovered that could be corrected with glasses. With glasses, an entirely new world opened to the student. For the first time in her life, she saw clearly the words before her. The salary of that country school teacher was meager, but out of the little she had, she made an investment that completely changed the life of a failing student. In doing so, she found a new dimension in her own life. It is not enough just to be good. We must be good for something. We must contribute good to the world. The world must be a better place for our presence. And the good that is in us must be spread to others. This is the measure of our civility. I don't suppose that many of us will be remembered 1,000 years from now. But in this world so filled with problems, so constantly threatened by dark and evil challenges, we can and must rise above mediocrity, above indifference. We can become involved and speak with a strong voice for that which is right and good. And we can lend our efforts and our resources to helping those who have been saddled with handicaps and burdens. James Russell Lowell in The Vision of Sir Launfal wrote, "Who gives himself with his alms feeds three, himself, his hungry neighbor, and me." Caring for others, seeing and teaching beyond our own wants and comforts, cultivating kindness and gentility toward others from all of life's situations and circumstances. These are the essence of civility, a virtue to be admired, a virtue to be acquired. Thank you.
Bob, you want to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, before you guys leave, I want to introduce this gentleman here. This is Joe Tai.
Good morning.
And I think a lot of you remember Joe. But Joe, I want to introduce you to Joe Tai here.
So, you know, it's Silicon Valley, we're trying to innovate. We like Joe Tai so much that we had to get our own. So, you know, dark suit, got some black shoes.
Red tie, right? Red tie? Yeah.
Wait a minute.
Red tie, oh. But he said you got to take your rose-colored glasses off, right? So, see what else. We got LASIK. I had LASIK, but oh, hold on a second. Mine was a little bit better experience than Joe's. I got my core values, right? My core values. And my daily promises, right? But I've got a, you know, these are kind of hard to remember. So I've got my, you want to hear my affirmation is?
Yes.
So I look in the mirror every morning and I say, I'm good enough, I'm smart enough, and doggone it, people like me. I don't know what else. What else is the same? I think that's about all. So I like to have a good time. Joe likes to have a good time. I've got some really bad dandruff.
I don't think Joe's got that problem.
I'm not. So you'll have to forgive me.
So.
We love you, Joe.
Isn't it embarrassing to be so obvious?
So, Joe, I have the reputation of being cheap Charlie, so instead of paying for a consultant, we decided we were going to just create our own job. And we're going to do the road show. We're trying him out with Star Valley Medical Center. If that turns out, then we're going to put him on the road. So if you ever get in a bind and you need another Joe, we can rent him out to you. So,
does that mean I can go hiking today and you can take over?
Okay, so... Joe and I go back for several years, and I truly believe in what he's saying, and ultimately what he's here for is to help improve our culture, and that's why wouldn't we all want that? And so that's what the next hour and a half is going to be, and if you guys are going to be at the later session, you can go ahead and mosey on out and come back at the later time, but. Anyway, Joe, we appreciate you being
Thank
here.
You.
And we'll turn it over to you. Thank you.
I'll have to say I've never had an introduction like that. Is it too obvious if I take my coat off? Because all of a sudden I'm really warm. And I especially want to thank all my invisible friends in the front row here. How do you even start after a morning like that? Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, the 12 core action values. Core action value number 10 is enthusiasm, right? So let's try this again. Good morning.
Good morning.
There we go. This morning, I want to talk about leadership. And some of what I'm going to say you all have heard, I'm going to talk about some things that probably you haven't heard yet. But if you look at the word, you'll notice that it's leadership with a small L. So we're not talking about the kind of leadership that requires a title. We're talking about the kind of leadership that anybody can provide. In the mid-1970s, a professor named James McGregor Burns wrote a book called Leadership. It won the Pulitzer Prize. And he talked about two kinds of leadership. One he called transactional leadership. That's running a business, making the transactions work. People give you money, you give them a product or a service, or in a hospital, you take care of them. People give you time, you give them a paycheck. You do the marketing, you do all the things you have to do to run a business. That's management. That's transactional leadership. The other kind of leadership he talked about is transformational leadership. That is changing people. That is raising people to a higher level of values, to a higher level of personal expectations. And that kind of leadership doesn't require a title. You think about the people who are the leaders we most admire. Nobody told Candy Leitner she had to start Mothers Against Drunk Driving after her daughter had been run over and killed by a drunk driver. She saw a need. She saw that she was in a position not to just be a victim by the fact that she'd lost a daughter, but there was something she could do to prevent any other parent from having to go through the grief that she was going through. Nobody told Martin Luther King to march in Birmingham and Selma. Nobody told the people who joined him to go. And trust me, they didn't march with him because they wanted to take a walk. There were a lot of places they could have taken a walk. Management is a job description. Your boss can give you a management title and a job description and a pay raise and move you up a little bit higher on the chart here. Leadership is a life decision. You choose to stand a little higher, look a little farther, make a commitment to do something, and you don't need anybody's permission to do that. You don't need a job title to do that. That's something that you do because it's in your heart to do it. You do it because that's how you live your values. You do it because you want to make a commitment to making a better world. And in today's world, and it's more complex, it's more fast-changing, it's more hyper-competitive today than the last time I was in Star Valley, the last time I was in Afton, and it's going to be more so. And in today's world, we need leadership in every corner, not just in the corner office. And that's really what the 12 Core Action Values is about, and it's really what the things I'm going to share with you are about. But some of you don't know me that well, although you know me better now than you did 10 minutes ago. So I'm a recovering hospital administrator. So that's true. I have a sponsor. I go to meetings, the whole nine yards. And I've been with Values Coach now for 20 years. And my wife and I live on a small farmstead in Iowa. We grow rocks, weeds, all it. Rescue animals my daughter brings home. We also have a second home in Arizona. And when we were looking to buy our second home, my wife had her own ideas, but this is what I wanted. I wanted to have a magnificent backyard. And if you've ever been in Arizona and seen that landscape, the topography, the rock structures, the cactus, how gorgeous it can be, that's what I wanted in my backyard. But I don't do yard work, so I didn't want to have to mess with it. And once we found our dream home in Arizona, we had to be able to afford it, of course. Now, do you have a sort of a picture in your mind of what that would look like? Second home in Arizona, magnificent backyard? Probably not. That's my second home. It's a tent in the Grand Canyon. I try to spend a week there every year. Look at that backyard. Can you imagine a more amazing backyard than the Grand Canyon? And you know what? If I get tired of the view, I pick up the house and move it. And down there, not only is it no maintenance, well, maintenance would be illegal. It's against the law. I don't even have to feel guilty for not wanting to do anything. That tent cost me $250. And a backcountry permit is $5 a night. So for $35, I can have a week vacation in my second home in the Grand Canyon. So I mentioned we live on a small farm in Iowa. I'll show you a picture of the house we lived in for 20 years. Raised our kids in this house. A lot of memories in this house. This picture taken a little over 2 years ago. Now, some of you are making an assumption about what you're seeing here, but you're wrong. Because after almost 20 years of planning and dreaming and saving, we finally could go to the county and say, we want to build a new house on the corner of our 12-acre little farm. And the county said, fine, we'll give you a permit, but you have to tear down the old house. And I thought, well, what a waste that would be. Tear down a perfectly good house. So I called up the fire department. Would you like to burn it down for a training exercise? What do you think they said? You know, and I know, every firefighter in the world is really a pyromaniac in drag. And there's some important lessons here. Lesson number one, things are not always what they seem. When you saw the picture of that burning house, you made some assumptions, but you're wrong. When you look at another person and you make assumptions about that person, you judge that person based on the costume they wear to work, the car they drive, the color of their skin. When you do that, you're just acting out human nature. That is human nature. We look at other people, we instantly make judgments based on appearances. You can't stop that from happening because it is human nature. What you can do is you can recognize it when it happens. And you can remind yourself, there's a human being behind that costume, and not make judgments. When I used to be the chief operating officer of a very big hospital in Massachusetts. And every 3 months, I would take about a half day, and I'd wear a housekeeper costume and do that job. Tell me. Do you think I got treated the same when I was wearing my housekeeper costume and pushing a mop as when I was wearing my executive costume and carrying a clipboard? No. Totally different. I mean, I'm exactly and precisely the same human being, but people would look at me and make totally different assumptions about my education, my ambition, my personality, who I was, whether bugs liked me. Lesson number two, what you really want might be closer than you think it is if you change your definitions, if you change your assumptions. If my definition of a second home in Arizona had walls and a swimming pool, I'd never have it. I wouldn't want it. But when I change the definition to a 2.5-pound tent, then it gets a whole lot easier. And think about what it is you want that you haven't been able to achieve yet. And it might just be that you need to change your assumptions. It might just be that you need to change your definitions. Lesson number three, this might be one of the hardest ones. If you want to move ahead in life, sometimes you have to be able to let go of the things that are holding you back. And quite often, that is the emotional baggage that we all carry around. And it happens at a personal level, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. But it also happens in organizations. I have worked with organizations as recently as yesterday that I swear have institutional PTSD. Things that happened years ago, and they still hang on to the old trauma. And if they can't let go of that, they can't move ahead. And think about, what is it that's holding you back? What's the emotional baggage? What's the fear that's stopping you from doing what you have to do to achieve the goals that are important to you? We all have that. What's the old anger, the old grudge that's holding down your self-esteem? Who are you blaming for your problems? Sometimes there are people who aren't even alive anymore and you're still holding it against them. And you got to learn how and be willing to let go of that. And number four, there's always a way, if you're thinking creatively, there's always a way to create a win-win. For us, it would have cost a lot more to hire a contractor, come in and dismantle that old house than it did to have the fire department come in and light a match, burn it down, and then just shovel everything in. And the fire department does not very often get a real house to play with. And that's what they did. For 4 months, they had smoke drills, fire drills, nighttime drills. They brought their girlfriends to impress them with how tough they were, literally. I have a little video clip. The day it was burning, we had firefighters come from every surrounding county. And at one point, they're all standing in front of the house. They got their helmets and their axes and they're going, and their wives and girlfriends are taking pictures. And in the background, it's on this video clip, in the background you hear this voice say, "Fine job you guys are doing." And so I need to say a word or two about assumptions, because we all make assumptions, and the assumptions you make really define how you see the world, how you see yourself, and what you can accomplish. So take a minute, please, and just read what's in the black circle. And what happens when you take the word assume and break it down? What do you get? Let me introduce you. And I'm gonna show you a very quick video here. I think some of you have seen it before, but I'm gonna show it again. See if you can identify the assumption that's being made here. See, those assumptions, they'll get you in trouble every time. So this morning, as Charlie said, we're working on culture, and I am going to talk about culture, but in a much different way than we have in the past. I really want to talk about you. But first, a few things about culture. Peter Drucker, the great management philosopher and guru, was the first one who said, "Culture eats strategy for lunch." Culture is the personality, it's the character of your organization. Yesterday I was at a critical access hospital in Idaho. Today I'm here. It takes about 10 minutes or less for a stranger to walk into the hospital I was at yesterday and another 10 minutes to walk around here to say, "Wow, those are two totally different places." Not because of what you do, not because of your buildings, but because of the way you make that person feel, and that's culture. So imagine you're coming to visit me in my small town of Solon, Iowa, which makes Star Valley which makes Afton look really big. We don't have a theater or anything like that. And we have two diners in town. And the menus are pretty much the same. Price is pretty much the same. Which diner will I take you to? Diner number one or diner number two? Which one am I going to pick? Probably two. Think about this. It's not the food. It's not the price. What is determining whether I take you to one or two is their culture. And that is not a trick question. That is the reality of our world today. Costco and Walmart, they're in the same business, aren't they? They sell the same products. They hire the same kind of people, do the same kind of marketing. But the experience of shopping with or working for, those two could not be any more different, could it? Last year, a little over a year ago, Business Week ran a cover story on Costco, and they wrote about ecstatic employees. Tell me, when's the last time you ever heard Walmart accused of having ecstatic employees? And you have to pay for the privilege of shopping at Costco. They won't let you in the door if you haven't bought a membership for about $50. People shop at Walmart because they don't have to dress up like they do for the dollar store. And if you've been to Walmart, you know. Southwest Airlines, United Airlines, they're in the same business, aren't they? They buy the same planes from Boeing, hire the same kind of people to fly and maintain those planes. But again, the experience of being an employee or a passenger simply could not be any more different. One way it's reflected is in the pre-flight instructions. You see, at United, the flight attendant thinks, I've done the job if I read the script. Whether or not anybody's listening, I fly United a lot and nobody ever is. Put on your seatbelt, put on your gas mask. At Southwest Airlines, they know the job is not just standing there like a robot reading the script. And by the way, there are an awful lot of people in healthcare who they think that's the job. They think it's okay to come in and do the work with a lousy attitude and treat people with the kind of disrespect. As long as they're doing what's in their job description, they think that's okay. At Southwest Airlines, they know that's not okay. It's not okay just to read the script. You got to make sure people are hearing what you say because it's important. If you have David Holmes here, he does it as a rap song. You can Google it. Over 1 million people have viewed this. He gets people clapping and snapping and zapping with him, and then he goes through the whole safety thing as a rap song. You cannot ignore him. And someone's going to pull out a cell phone and videotape it, and Southwest Airlines gets millions of dollars of free advertising. We could get together and do the Blues Brothers. And then there's the Southwest flight attendant who does this. She starts out by saying, ladies and gentlemen, welcome aboard. And I want you to know that we have a very special passenger with us today. John Taylor is on board, and it's his birthday. He is 104 years old today. And you know what he told me when they wheeled him on this morning with his O2 tank? This is the first time in his entire life he has ever been on a jet airplane. So, folks, on your way out, would you all kindly stick your head in the cockpit and say happy birthday. Now tell me, with that introduction, will you pay more careful attention to the safety instructions? One of the exercises we often do, describe the culture of your organization in 6 words. It's really a fascinating thing. And here's the paradox. The more powerful, the more positive, the stronger your culture is, the easier that is to do. And in organizations that don't have a clear picture of what their culture is, it's really hard. Southwest Airlines has a motto: servant's heart, warrior spirit, fun-loving attitude. If you count the hyphen in 6 words, that really captures the culture of Southwest. Anybody ever fly Southwest? If I asked you to capture the culture of Southwest Airlines in just one word, what one word would you pick? Fun. Anybody who knows the company knows that's what in three letters, you can capture the essence of the culture of Southwest Airlines. There's a company in the Silicon Valley called Cypress Semiconductor. They call themselves the Marine Corps of Silicon Valley. You don't wear sandals to work there like you do at Google. Don't expect free food there. No beer badges on Friday. And if you didn't show up for work on Sunday, don't bother coming in on Monday. And the best thing there about Friday is there's only two more working days until Monday. Their CEO wrote a book called No Excuses Management. They have eight core values. One of them is we do not tolerate losing. That's one of their core values. They don't have to say we don't tolerate losers either. Now, this company never, ever makes hiring mistakes. Why? Who would even apply to work at a company called the Marine Corps of Silicon Valley, where a core value is we don't tolerate losers and no excuses accepted, if they didn't have that sort of mental toughness and that competitive drive? And that is when you're that clear about who you are, what you stand for, what you won't stand for, what your culture is, you attract the kind of people you want to work with, and then they stay. A few days ago, I was at another hospital. I was talking about Southwest Airlines. Actually, it was at the hospital cooperative on Monday. I was talking about Southwest Airlines. There was a woman in the room. She said, my son-in-law is a pilot for Southwest. He has been offered a lot more money to fly for Delta, but he wouldn't even think about it because he loves working at Southwest so much. That is the power of having a great culture. So we do this exercise. And as I said, organizations that are not clear about their culture really have a hard time with it. And I was at a big academic medical center doing a leadership retreat, and we had everybody at round tables. So each table, I gave them 5 minutes, and I said, come up with your six-word description of your culture. We love patients and each other. Is that pretty good, pretty cool? Okay, in the world of public speaking, this is what's known as audience participation. Is that a pretty good culture description? Yeah. Sure. We are always here for you. How's that? That's pretty good. Multiple priorities, limited resources, great expectations. Are we starting to get a different picture? Disjointed departments working against each other. How do you spell silo? Negativity reigns while circling the drain. We're entitled, hating it, and staying. Beatings will continue until morale improves. How can people, managers in the same organization, have such a different picture of what the culture of the place is? And the reason is they don't have a clear picture. They don't have a cultural blueprint. They don't know what they expect of people. What would this mean for me if I'm a new employee? It'd be a crapshoot. Am I going to work in a department where we are always there for you? Or in a department where, let's see if we have, no. There was another one. I would love to help, but. So when you're not clear as an organization about what your culture is, what you expect, you end up with this sort of ugly patchwork quilt. You have a different culture in nursing or pharmacy or housekeeping, different day shift, night shift, weekend culture. Even within nursing, there's a different culture in ER, OR, med surg, pediatrics, whatever. When you're clear about your culture, my wife has a pretty significant medical condition, and we went to the Mayo Clinic. Everywhere we went, we got treated the same. And everywhere we went, that treatment, I would have rated an A++++. On the other side of the, well, not too far away, actually, at Cleveland Clinic, they are working very hard to create a culture of empathy because they're very well known, for good reason, for having a cold, sterile, impersonal culture that treats patients like lab rats. They do the same thing. They have the same clinical outcomes. What's the difference? Culture. And here's the deal. You know, we get calls all the time, can you help us work on changing our culture? Culture does not change until and unless people change. Because what culture really is, it's the collective attitudes, behaviors, and habits of the people who work there. And if nobody changes how they're thinking, if nobody changes their attitude, if nobody changes how they treat each other, culture isn't going to change. And that is an invisible barrier on the performance potential of your organization, also on each of us individually. It's our own attitude, our own habits, our own behaviors. And I've shown some of you this picture before, but I like it so well, I'm showing it again. I found this on the internet. It raises a really good question, doesn't it? This tabby cat looking in the mirror and seeing the lion look back. And the question it raises is, who could you be if you could look in the mirror and instead of pretending to see less than what's really there, which is what most of us do, you know, the Bible asks the question, who would light a candle and put a basket over it? But we all do that. What if instead of doing that, you could look in the mirror and see your best self looking back at you every day? What if you didn't let fear stop you from doing what you have to do to be that best self or to achieve your most important goals or dreams? I love this bumper sticker. I used to have superhuman powers, but my therapist took them all away. And isn't that what happens? You ask a little kid, what do you want to be when you grow up? And what do they think they can be? Anything. Superman, Batman, astronaut, president. Although, who'd want to be? Have you ever asked a little kid, what do you want to be when you grow up? And had him say, oh, I don't know, sit in a dark cubicle and do spreadsheets till I get laid off. What happens to those dreams? You know, they get squashed. We run into parents and teachers and schoolyard bullies. And the challenge in life is how do you remember, reclaim, re-spark, revitalize those dreams? At Values Coach, we have put a lot of thought into what is a great culture? What is a culture of ownership? What does it look like? And it's really these three things. It's six words. In a culture of ownership, people are emotionally positive, they are self-empowered, and they are fully engaged. Those three qualities make a great culture. If you have those three things, you're going to provide great patient care. Your patients are going to be satisfied off the charts. It's going to be a great place to work. Tell me, if you personally could be more emotionally positive, more self-empowered, more fully engaged, would you be a happier person? The audience participation thing. You know, here's how it works. Seriously, would you be happier?
Yes.
Would you get more done?
Yes.
And so one of the things that we're challenging people to do, and I'm challenging you, is to actually take this commitment, the Florence Challenge commitment. And Pam, can you get everybody, do you have these in your office or something?
I actually copied them up this morning.
Thank you. So when somebody signs this certificate, they're making a personal commitment to themselves, to their families, to the people they work with, to do more to be emotionally positive, to do more to be self-empowered, and to be fully engaged. And here's what we're seeing in hospitals all across the country, in Palmetto Health in South Carolina. First thing you see when you come on a patient care unit is their people have signed this and put their pictures next to it. So every patient knows if somebody's not being nice to them, they can say, I thought I saw your picture out there promising me that you're going to be these three things. This is Maine Medical Center in Portland, Maine. Midland Memorial Hospital in West Texas, they put their pictures and then they put pictures of spark plugs in there. If you think it's hard to get to Afton, try getting to Salmon, Idaho. That's Steel Memorial Hospital. And they're in the middle of nowhere. Grinnell Regional Medical Center in rural Iowa. You know, again, we're seeing all across the country, we're seeing people post these things. And at Kalispell Regional Healthcare, they even had Abby Doodle, the pet therapy dog, sign one with his paw prints and put his picture up next to it. And so I'm going to shift gears here in our last 55 minutes together. Up to now, I've been talking about the organization, about culture. You know, what are the six words that define your culture? Culture eats strategy for lunch. But remember I said that culture does not change unless and until people change. And so what I'd like to do is share with you six life-changing strategies. And they will. If you do these things, it'll help you be a better person. It'll help you achieve your goals more effectively. And if enough people in your hospital, if enough people in your family, if enough people in your community would take these things to heart, you'll have a better hospital, a better family, a better community. Number one, we all struggle with negative self-talk. We all have the little voice in the back of our head, the one that says, you're not smart enough, you're not good enough, you're not pretty enough, nobody likes you, you don't deserve... Am I the only one that hears that?
No.
You know what? It's human nature. One of the reasons why I am so... I'm on this mission to eradicate complaining in the workplace is because anytime somebody starts complaining about anything, what they're really doing is taking their own inner misery and dumping it on other people. That's why we use the word commiserate. Co-miserate. Be miserable together. If somebody is happy, they're not going to complain about things. If whatever it is they're complaining about, I had to wait 20 minutes to get on my plane. Poor baby. But it's not the 20 minutes. It's, well, some years back, we were working with a hospital. It was a long-term project. We had just started. It was May, Nurses Week. So I'm there for Nurses Week. Nobody knows who I am. All the executives had gone around to all the nursing units delivering Marie Callender pie. You know Marie Callender pie? The nutritional equivalent of heroin. And I'm in the CEO's office when they start coming back down. How'd it go? Oh, it was great. The nurses love the pie. 11 o'clock that night, I'm wandering around all alone. Nobody knows who I am. I'm on a nursing unit. I overhear this conversation. Nurse who's been there all day behind the computer. New nurse coming on duty for the night shift. Nurse who's been there all day says, there's pie in the staff lounge. All the suits came up today and brought us pie for Nurses Week. This year we get pie instead of a pay raise. Couple questions. Question number one. Is it possible for that nurse to be a negative, bitter, cynical, sarcastic, emotional vampire pickle sucker sitting at the nurse's station and then to walk into a patient's room and somehow flip a switch? And do patients see right through the fraud? You better believe it. They'll tell you. You can tell the ones who really care and the ones who are just here for a paycheck. Question number two. Is it possible for that nurse to be a negative, bitter, cynical, sarcastic, emotional vampire pickle sucker at work and then go home and somehow flip a switch and become a genuinely affirming, nurturing, empowering parent? Or is she going to go home and dump her negative attitudes on the kids, teach her kids, work sucks, then you die? And can you think of a worse disservice to do to a kid than to teach them that work is a four-letter word, just somehow, some way to pay for your hobbies, that it's something that makes you miserable? Because those kids are going to go out and they're going to compete for jobs in a world where there are other kids who think work ought to matter. You ought to be passionate about what you do. You ought to be excited about what you do. You ought to be engaged in what you do. And those kids are going to compete and they're going to lose. And they're going to end up dead-ended in dead-end jobs. And it's not going to be the skills they lack, it's going to be the attitude they lack. Another question. What kind of a night do you think the night shift nurse had? When literally the first thing to hit her in the face is this pie of toxic emotional negativity. You think it sets her up to have a great night? As opposed to maybe, hey, it's great to see you. One more question. Later that summer, the nurses at that hospital got a 13% pay raise. Wow. This was a while back. Tell me, do you think that nurse went around and said, hey guys, guess what? I was wrong. This year we got pie and a pay raise. What a great, you think?
No.
What do you think it was? Wasn't enough. Is that all? About time. I bet the suits got more. You see, when somebody is in that negative frame of mind, it doesn't matter what's out there. You fix what they're whining about today, they'll find something else to be whining about tomorrow or 5 minutes from now. And I, in 20 years of working with this, has become more and more clear to me that anytime somebody's complaining, all they're really doing is they're taking the dialogue that's already going on between their ears and projecting it outward. And that's what self-talk is. Self-talk is the collective stories that you tell yourself, about other people, about how the world works. It's your perspective on things, Saturday's promise. And we all give a speech. Most of us, many of us have taken a class on public speaking, but none of us have ever taken a class on the most important speech you ever give, which is the one that you give to yourself all day, every day. And in many cases, that's a negative speech. What's the first word that every baby learns to say?
No.
No. Why is that the first word they learn to say? That's all they hear. No, don't touch that. No, put that down. No, don't play in the street. No, sit down and shut up. We hear that first in kindergarten, and we never stop hearing it until the day we die, one way or another. Tell me, you go to the airport, and you walk into your waiting area to catch your flight, and there's only two people there. One of them is really weird. Tell me which one is weird. There's a guy slouched down under the TV set. He's got a big Cinnabon on one knee. He's got a latte flowing over with whipped cream on the other knee. He's reading the sports page from USA Today. The other guy is over by the window doing push-ups. In our society, which one is weird? What's wrong with this picture? That primordial no has become part of our culture. No, don't stand out. No, don't do what's good for you. No, don't try to be excellent. No, don't do push-ups. Sit there and pig out on a latte and a Cinnabon. Negative self-talk. This is all negative self-talk is. It is telling yourself lies, believing those lies, and then when you embrace them, they become your truth. But they're not authentic. They're not originally you. And what psychologists tell us is that the human mind automatically gravitates toward negative, frightening, depressing thoughts unless you're consciously paying attention and redirecting it elsewhere. Psychologists call it ANT, automatic negative thinking. And just like the army ants, it will chew you up if you're not paying attention to it. Psychologists tell us that about 80% of what goes on between our ears is negative unless you're paying attention and consciously redirecting it. We can abuse ourselves at 400 words a minute. And much of it is so far below the level of conscious awareness, it's like graffiti on a subway cart. You're not even paying attention to it. You're not even aware of what's happening unless you really step outside and look and see what's happening. And I'm sure that, like me, you say things to yourself that you would never tolerate from anybody else. You would never let anybody else call you the things that you call yourself. Why do you, and you wouldn't call anybody else that. You wouldn't talk to your child that way, would you? You wouldn't talk to a patient that way, would you? Why do you allow yourself to talk to you that way? And here's why. It's not you talking. Anytime you hear negative self-talk, I guarantee you this. It will always, always be in the second person. You will never hear that little voice say, I'm stupid, I'm fat, I'm ugly, I'm not good enough, nobody likes me. It's always as if someone else is talking to you. You idiot! How could you have done? Why is that? Because literally it is someone else talking to you. What you are hearing is an echo. It's a malignant echo. Things that people said to you long ago, they hurt, they stuck, they metastasized. That's what cancer does. And you almost literally have a form of PTSD. It's hardwired in. Now, there's good news, you can change that, but young lady, what's your name?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Shawnee. Shawnee?
Shawnee.
Are you a good sport?
I think so. I don't want to be embarrassed. I don't want to embarrass
me. We're going to find out if you're a good sport and how easily embarrassed you are.
I'm going red.
Okay, good. All right, let's say I'm giving a speech. Well, I am. I'm giving a speech. And I have just made my most powerful, most important point. The one that always gets people writing it down and saying, I'm going to do that, and clapping. And Shawnee here goes, What does the voice in the back of my head say? Joe, you are boring. Didn't I tell everyone to turn their cell phones off? Whoops. Don't you hate it when that happens? Tell me, speaking of negative self-talk, what happens to the rest of my presentation if I believe what that voice just told me? Joe, you are boring. Does it get better or worse? If I start to worry about it, oh, this isn't working. I'm going to have to get a real job. This isn't working. Does it get better or worse? And you see what happens by listening to that voice, by believing it's telling me the truth, I actually contribute to a self-fulfilling prophecy. Now, the fact that Shawnee here was up all night long at the bar, drinking and carousing, and now nothing could keep her awake. That voice will never give you the benefit of the doubt. It personalizes everything. Was it fun? That's why you have to separate yourself from it and recognize it is not you talking. And when it talks to you in an abusive way, it does not have your best interest at heart, and it is trying to talk you into being less than who you can really be. Well, close your eyes. I don't want you to see ahead. There we go. Okay, back. One more. Right there. I got a call yesterday from Michelle in my office. It's worse than a virus. Somebody will crack into your computer and put an encryption on all your files. And then they'll send you a blackmail notice. And you have to pay them before they will release all your files. We think that might have happened to Michelle's computer yesterday. Not a fun thing. So pay... this, what?
Think before you quit.
Think, but yeah, yeah.
$20.
Can you call Michelle for me? All right. Back on track here. Why is it so hard to talk back to the voice of negative self-talk? And for one reason, it's invisible. How can you talk back to something you can't even see? And so we play a little game. I call it metaphorical visualization. Create a metaphor, something that you can see, something that gives it tangible weight. And so every time I get negative self-talk, I visualize it for what it really is. It's mental graffiti. That's all it is. You have this old ghost, this little vandal running around in your head, spray painting the attic of your mind with negative self-talk. You're not good enough, you're not smart enough, you're not pretty enough, whatever it is. And that's what it's like. And you're so used to it, in fact, you may be even so comfortable with it now that you like it, you think it's pretty. Why? Because it keeps you in your comfort zone, it prevents you from taking risks, it prevents you from stepping out and standing out, and it's pretty comfortable just to be there. And you got to confront that voice. And so the second step, after you visualize it as graffiti, imagine you have a janitor up there. I call it the janitor in your attic, who goes around and erases it. This is my janitor. His name is Spike. And every time I get that negative self-talk, and I do, but I visualize, literally, Joe, you're boring. I'll close my eyes. I visualize that. You're boring as graffiti. I mean, I literally try to see the words. And then I see my little janitor Spike come along and paint it out and replace it with something positive. Now, I know what you're thinking. This is really silly. And it is. I agree. But tell me, is what you're doing now working? And about 10, not quite 10 years ago, I called one of the world's leading authorities on neuroplasticity, brain plasticity. That is the human mind's ability to rewire itself in response to thought and action. Little kids have incredible neuroplasticity. That's why they can learn new languages so fast. And the theory used to be that at somewhere around age 21, the drinking age, we lost that ability. Okay, I was...
21! I got out of that.
You know what? Charlie, because Charlie knows I like Miller Lite, and I usually have maybe one every evening. I'm going to be here for two nights. Charlie left a 12-pack of Miller Lite in the refrigerator at my hotel. I'm going to have 10 left over, so. Where was I? You know what ADD is? You don't. It's not. You think it's attention deficit disorder. It's not. It's a surplus. People with ADD are trying to pay attention to everything all at once. That's why we get so distracted.
That's where you were at. Neuroplasticism.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Thank you. What they're finding now is that with training, anybody at any age can actually rewire, physically rewire their brain. So, for example, if somebody has a stroke and this arm stops working, it used to be they would teach people to compensate by riding and eating with this arm. What do they do now? They tie down this arm. And eventually, this arm starts working, which means very directly that a part of the brain that had not been designed to make this arm go is now taking on the load. And the only way that can happen is if there's a physical rewiring in the brain. That is really exciting. And then they started doing more studies showing that just visualizing yourself doing something, which, like playing around a golf, just visualizing yourself running a race, you actually make, it's the same, your brain cannot distinguish between vivid imagination and reality. And so at a cognitive level, it's the same. Visualizing it and doing it is very much the same. I got so excited when I read a book about this, I called the author, who's the leading authority on it, and I told him about this silly game. And I asked him, I said, if somebody made a good faith effort to visualize negative self-talk as graffiti, and then they had a little mental cartoon character, and they made a little mental movie of this janitor painting out, would you be able to detect with fMRI, functional magnetic resonance imaging, or some other technology, would you be able to see a change in the physical wiring of their brain? He said, absolutely. After that, I got a whole lot more serious about doing this myself, a whole lot more emphatic about telling other people, you really have to do this. And I'm convinced now, 8 or 9 years later, that he was absolutely right, and that had he done an fMRI on me 8 years ago and again today, he would be able to say, this is what's different, and it would be in the right frontal cortex, by the way. Did you believe that?
Absolutely.
You know how easy it is to fool people to think you're an expert? You know, we know that, don't we, Eli? This it's such magic. What that's saying is that by changing the software, what you say when you talk to yourself, what you think, what your attitudes are, you can actually change the hardware. And the other question I asked him, I said, if somebody really made a good faith effort and their hardwiring did change, would negative self-talk be pop up less automatically? And he said, oh yeah, absolutely. He said, eventually it would become the exception and not the norm in how you think. And when it did pop up, you would recognize it a lot more quickly. Caveat, if what that voice is telling you is true, you really are out of shape, overweight, and not ready for the test tomorrow, don't try to erase it. Listen to it and do what you have to do to change the situation. Leave the bar and go to the library. Go work out, whatever it is. But here's a clue. If it's true, you're more likely going to hear it in the first person, not second person. You won't hear, you are not ready for the test tomorrow. You hear, oh my, I'm not ready for the test tomorrow. If you hear something in the first person, pay attention, because chances are that is authentic. That is you talking, you telling your best self, telling you what you have to do. Second strategy I wanted to share with you of the six. Get your body into the act. There is another exciting new field of science called psychoneuroimmunology. It's about the relationship between body, mind, spirit, emotions. And we all know We all know that your mind talks to your body and tells it what to do, right? Your mind says to your body, can I borrow a pen for a minute? Thank you. I'll give it back, but remind me if I don't. Your mind says, pick up the pen, and your body picks up the pen and starts writing. It also works in reverse. Your body talks to your mind. Were you just brushing your hair, or did you have a question? Okay, all right. You know, I've learned this the hard way. Never do that at an auction. I have a hideous painting. Charlie Brown says, I'm going to borrow this again in a minute, okay? You know, Charlie Brown says, if you're going to be depressed, you've got to stand like this. And what the science now shows is if you're in a good mood and you slouch around like this for a couple hours, you're going to be depressed. If you're depressed, if you're anxious, and you go for a quick walk, put a smile on your face, go play a game of racquetball, hit a punching bag, whatever you do, you're going to be in a better mood. Why? Because your body is your body and your mind cannot be in two different states for an extended period of time. If you're slouched down like this, you can't be happy. Not eventually. And if you're walking fast and got a smile on your face, it's much harder for you at a mental, at a cognitive level, to be depressed. Amy Cuddy, C-U-D-D-Y, she's a professor at the Harvard Business School. This video, it's a TED Talk, has seen more than 30 million views. And she talks about power posing. And what she says is, don't just fake it till you make it, fake it till you become it. And so, for example, what their research shows is if somebody's going in for a job interview or a sales call, if they will take 2 minutes beforehand and do power posing, like Wonder Woman there, do it in the bathroom, otherwise you won't get the job. But 2 minutes of what she calls power posing will put you in a completely different frame of mind. Not only that, you will project yourself in a different way and get a different reaction from people. And their research shows that 2 minutes of power posing makes it much more likely you're going to get the job or make the sale. And that's getting your body into the act. Also, get your mouth into the act. There was a study done. Some psychologists did a fun study. They broke groups into two and gave them a set of cartoons and asked them to read them and rate how funny the cartoons were. And one group always rated them as being very funny, and the other group never did. Same cartoons. Here's the deal. Can I borrow your pen again? Thank you. They had to hold the pen in their mouth when they circled the funny or not funny on the form. One group was told, hold the pen in your lips. The other group was told, hold the pen with your teeth. I did brush my teeth this morning. Which group do you think consistently, every time, rated the cartoons as funny, lips or teeth? And which is not funny, lips or teeth? Think of the implications of this. The shape of your mouth is telling your brain, before you have even read the cartoons, whether you're going to think they're funny or not. What is the implication of that for if you're a manager, you're about to have a tough performance appraisal? Versus the shape of your mouth, the posture of your body tells your mind what you're going to think, what you're going to perceive, how you're going to react. And so wouldn't it make sense to sit up straighter, to walk a little faster, to keep a smile on your face as one way of changing your life? If you smile from the outside in, eventually you'll be smiling from the inside out. Now, if I go to the dentist and they come in wearing these, I might not open my mouth. The third strategy. As I said at the outset, we all carry around emotional baggage. That is the human condition. And why is it so hard to leave it behind? Why is it so hard to set aside the fear that stops you from doing what you have to do? Why is it so hard to stop thinking about the bad things that your parents did to you 180 years ago? Because those things are, it's invisible. How do you set aside emotional baggage you can't see? You ever feel like this? Like you got this long train of emotional baggage you're hauling around behind you? Wouldn't it be nice if you could take it to the airport and check it in? Yes, I want to send all my emotional baggage to Toledo. You would have a conversation with the TSA pretty quickly, I think. And you know, it's almost like when you're born, you're given a backpack, an invisible backpack. And as you go through life, you stuff it full of all of these experiences, these assumptions and beliefs about yourself. I never, I always, I'm not. It's that negative self-talk. And it's invisible. And it drags you down, slows you down, causes you pain. Every year I try to spend at least a week, sometimes two, below the rim of the Grand Canyon. Sometimes alone, it's glorious. Sometimes I take a few people with me. Whenever I go, I think of some emotional baggage that I want to leave behind. What is the fear that's stopping me from doing what I have to do to take values coach to a higher level? What is the old anger that I just can't seem to get rid of? What's the source of low self-esteem that's keeping me from becoming a better person than I am now? There's always something. I pick up an ugly rock. I once had a geologist tell me, well, there's no such thing as an ugly rock. I stick it in my backpack and I carry it for a week. Now, if you're carrying a 60-pound pack in 102-degree heat, in the rough terrain of Grand Canyon, and somebody slips a hummingbird feather in it, you know it just got heavier. And a rock like this is a great metaphor for the pain that's holding you down, keeping you back. And if I have a group with us on the last day, we build a cairn. We have a ceremony, and everybody sets their rock on the cairn. By the way, what is a cairn? It marks a trail. Who builds cairns? People who don't need them. By definition, they know where the trail goes. They don't need a cairn. That's why they can build it. Who are they building it for? Other people. What other people? Other people they will never meet, much less be thanked for by, much less be paid for by. And it's a great metaphor for today's promise, isn't it? To be a cairn builder, to make a contribution without any expectation of being repaid for it. And we set our rock on the cairn. I have seen people make amazing changes. So here's the way it works. You carry your rock around. Every day you pull it out and you talk to it. Have any of you done this? I know I've shared this with some of you before. Every day you take the rock out and you talk to it. And you tell it why you're going to leave it behind. And if you do this in good faith, I mean you really talk to it out loud, and explain why it's not coming out with you, on usually the third or fourth day, the rock will talk back to you. I don't mean literally, unless you're really dehydrated or hungover. Here's how one guy's conversation went. He says to the rock, this job I'm in now is killing my soul. I hate it. And there's something I need to do. I want to start a business doing something I love to do. I know I could fail at business, but right now I'm failing at life. I think I could recover from failing at business, but I don't know if I could recover from failing at life. I need to do this. And in this imagined conversation, he heard the rock say to him on the third or fourth day, don't get me wrong, I'm with you. I want you to quit that job. Just not now. It's not a good time. You don't have your retirement account taken care of. Your kids aren't out of school yet. The economy's not very good. Why don't you wait until... What is that a formula for? Failure. Why? Endless procrastination. But think of how seductive that voice is. It's not saying, oh no, never. It's saying, someday but not now, but that someday never comes. And on the last day we built our cairn, he set his rock down. And as he walked out with the commitment that he was going to follow his heart. And he did. He started his business first, before he quit the day job, tried to get it going. You know what he told me later? He said, I finally recognized whose voice I had been listening to, whose voice had stopped me from taking action all those years. It was the voice of my dad, who had been dead for years. A dead man's voice was preventing me from following my dreams and quitting the job that was killing my soul. And he says, now I know how unfair I was being to the memory of my dad. Because now I know if he was still alive, if I went to him and said, Dad, this job is killing my soul. And there's something I really want to do. I know I could fail, but I'm going to give it my best. He would not have given me a lecture. He would have given me a loan. He'd have been my best supporter. And what I was doing is I was using the memory of my dad as an excuse for my own cowardice. He was my excuse. Don't quit your day job. Be responsible. But that's not what he would have said. And when he finally realized what was going on, he was able to set that rock aside and move on. And as I said, I have literally seen people make miraculous changes just by recognizing this dead weight that they've been carrying around. And then finally setting it aside. We did, when we do our 5-day course for values trainers, and some of you have been through it, on the first day we dump a pile of rocks in the front of the room. And then I tell people about this exercise. I invite them to come pick up a rock, carry it around for a week. And the last day we build a cairn and we say goodbye to our rocks. And if people want to, they can tell us what the rock is. And I'll never forget, we were doing a program with the Veterans Health Administration. And there were two women in the course. And on the fifth day, so one woman brings, we build our cairn up front. And I tell people, I'm going to haul these rocks off into a mountain or out onto a river or whatever. You're never going to see it again. One woman drops a rock on the ground and she stomps on it. And she says, this rock is the priest who raped me 40 years ago. She said, there has not been a day in 40 years that I haven't experienced the anger and the hatred and the humiliation. And I am so tired. And I'm leaving this rock behind. I'm never going to think of that again. And another woman brought up a bigger rock. She had written words all over it. Words like unwanted, unloved, disposable, discarded. She had been raised in 12 different foster homes, thrown out of each one. She is now happily married. She's a good mom. She's got a job she loves. She's making a difference in the lives of the veterans that she serves. But she cannot let go of this self-image that somehow she herself is unwanted and unlovable. She handed me the rock. She said, I don't want you to take this with the others and dump it somewhere. I want you to find a corner where you know there's going to be a homeless person with a sign and leave it there for that person to find. Because, she said, I have wrapped this rock in an invisible prayer. And that prayer is that whoever picks up this rock will relieve me of the burden, but they will also know that, number one, they're not alone. And number two, there's always hope. No matter how far you have fallen, there is always hope that you can set that burden aside and that you can have a more happy life. I got emails from each one of those two women within the next 3 or 4 months, long emails describing the changes they had made, the peace they had gained by letting go of those rocks, and they both used the word miracle. And then something I know many of you know. It's the other side of the laminated card with the self-empowerment pledge on it. It's the pickle pledge. We call it the pickle pledge because people who are always whining and complaining look like they've been sucking on a dill pickle. I took this picture about a month ago at the Atlanta airport. Southwest Airlines is now using the attitude of their employees as a marketing campaign. All airline employees have attitudes. Ours just have the good kind. A question. If Charlie decided to put billboards up on either side of Afton that had a picture of a person, a nurse, somebody, and it said, all hospital employees have attitudes. Ours just have the good kind. What would be the reaction of most people driving by those billboards? Okay, this is the audience participation thing, and this is a more difficult question. But what would be the reaction of your fellow citizens in this community as they drove by and saw that that claim being made by the hospital.
Depends on what experience they've had here. Some might say they are right. Some might say they're not.
Okay. Say again?
But it depends on their own attitude and what they decide from that.
Yeah. What would be the breakdown? How many would be yeah, right versus yeah, right? 50-50?
I think it's higher.
I disagree.
Higher on which side?
On the good side.
On the good side?
I think people have...
Raise your hand if you think it would be, more people would be yeah, right than less. Raise your hand if you think it would be yeah, right would be more than less. Put your head on your hand if you don't care. You know, from what I know about Star Valley Medical Center and my friends here, from, you know, the conversations I've had with people outside of the hospital, which are fairly minimal, I'd have to agree. I think you're unusual. I was at a place yesterday where and I asked them if they put up that billboard and it was 100%. They'd roll their eyes, yeah, right. The attitudes of the people in the hospital will profoundly influence the perspective of the people outside, and it's not just the quality of care. In fact, I don't know what you're doing to me clinically, but I do know how you make me feel. And so for some of you, this is a review, but a positive workplace begins with intolerance for toxic emotional negativity. You know, if you wanted to, that is turned off. If you wanted to create a more healthy workplace, you brought in treadmills and stair steppers, you had broccoli and asparagus in the cafeteria, you gave everybody 15 minutes a day to yogify or take a walk or something like that, but you let people smoke everywhere in the hospital, would that be a healthy workplace? The non-negotiable first step is to get rid of the stuff that causes harm before you can start doing the things that are helpful. And it's the same thing with culture. If you're trying to create a more positive culture, but your culture tolerates two people talking about a coworker behind that person's back, your culture tolerates people just sitting around whining and complaining without doing something about it, you're not going to have as positive a culture as you could have. And I know here I'm preaching to the choir, and I'm not being critical of you guys. You're a lot better than almost anybody we work with. Can you be better than where you are now? Absolutely. And it says in the book that you all, I think, have, one toxic negative person can drag down morale, productivity, everything else, the way one person lighting a cigarette in this room would instantly pollute every other lung in the room. And unfortunately, when it comes to creating a positive workplace culture, we are swimming against the tide. We have done surveys, we've done culture assessment surveys with many of our clients, and it's got 12 questions. One of them is this: our people have positive attitudes, treat others with respect, and do not engage in bitching, moaning, whining, complaining, gossiping, finger pointing, rumor mongering, and other forms of toxic emotional negativity. I just recently collated, actually, it's even more than this now. The last 20 surveys we did, more than 7,000 responses, all healthcare. More people disagree with that statement than agree with it. In hospitals, in nursing homes, in nursing schools. And look how many people strongly agree, less than 6%. And that is the healthcare crisis. That's the inside healthcare crisis. If every single person in every hospital, every long-term care facility, every clinic in America strongly agreed that we have positive attitudes, we treat people with respect, and we do not whine and complain and gossip, we would not have a healthcare crisis today. We would have problems, we would deal with them, we deal with them effectively. But rather than me talk about it, let me turn it over to a real authority, a comedian. This guy is Louis C.K., and I don't watch TV, but he's on some late night TV show. This is called Everything's Amazing and Nobody's Happy.
Yeah. Those were simpler times, I think. I just feel like we may be going back to that, by the way. But in a way, good. Because when I read things like the foundations of capitalism are shattering, I'm like, maybe we need that. Maybe we need some time where we're walking around with a donkey with box playing on the sides.
You think that would just bring us back to reality?
Yeah, because everything is amazing right now and nobody's happy. Like, in my lifetime, the changes in the world have been incredible. When I was a kid, we had a rotary phone. We had a phone we had to stand next to, and you had to dial it.
Yes.
You're really helping. You're making sparks. And you actually would hate people with zeros in their numbers because it was more. Zeros. Screw that guy. And then if they called and you weren't home, the phone would just ring lonely by itself. And then when you wanted money, you had to go in the bank. Of course, the phone was open for like 3 hours. And you'd stay in line, write some check like an idiot. And then when you ran out of money, you just go, well, I can't do any more things now. That was it. And even if you had a credit card, the guy would go, oh, so you bring out this whole strange
Do you feel that we now, in the 21st century, we take technology for granted?
Well, yeah, because now we live in an amazing, amazing world, and it's wasted on the crappiest generation of just spoiled idiots that don't care, because this is what people are like now. They got their phone, and they're like, it won't. Give it a second. It's going to space. And there was internet, high-speed internet on the airplane. That's the newest thing that I know exists. And I'm sitting on the plane, they go, open up your laptop, you can go on the internet. It's fast, and I'm watching YouTube clips. I'm in an airplane. And then it breaks down. And they apologize, the internet's not working. The next thing they go, this is bull. Like, how quickly the world owes him something he knew existed only 10 seconds ago. Because people come back from flight and they tell you their story. And it's like a horror story. If they act like their flight was like a cattle car in the 40s in Germany. That's how bad it makes it sound.
Right.
They're like, it was the worst day of my life. First of all, we didn't board for 20 minutes. Right. And then we get on the plane and they made us sit there on the runway for 40 minutes. We had to sit there. Oh, really? What happened next? Did you fly through the air incredibly like a bird? Did you partake in the miracle of human flight and not contributing zero? Look, you're flying! It's amazing! Everybody on every plane should just constantly be going, oh my god! You're sitting in a chair in the because you go back a lot. And it's not really. You know, here's the thing. People, like, they say there's delays on flights.
Yeah.
Delays, really? New York to California in 5 hours. That used to take 30 years. And a bunch of you would die on the way there and have a baby. You'd meet a whole different group of people by the time you got there. Now you watch a movie and you take a dump in your home. That's the way to say it.
Do any of you fly? Has he more or less nailed it?
Yeah.
Like, what's wrong with this picture? And as you know, the Pickle Pledge is a very simple promise. It says, I will turn every complaint into a blessing or a constructive suggestion. I had to park 6 blocks away and walk all the way to the mall. Thank God you have legs. A lot of people in wheelchairs would give anything to have your aching feet. Thank God you have a mall and money to spend in the mall. And you don't live in Somalia where they have no such luxuries. Oh, by the way, if you ate fewer Cinnabons and spent more time on a treadmill, maybe walking 6 blocks wouldn't be such a hardship. And there's nothing you can complain about that you cannot find with conscious effort, a blessing in it, and or something you can do about it instead of just whining and complaining. And this pickle challenge is literally taking on a life of its own. We are seeing singing pickles, dancing pickles, hula pickles, pickle pinatas, people putting up pickle-free zone signs. I was so impressed with this, we stole the idea. We're now, Values Coach now sells door hangers declaring your workspace a pickle-free zone. I don't want to hear it. Take it to your shrink. He gets paid to hear it. In Kalispell, at Kalispell Regional Healthcare, they hired a professional artist to come into their home health department. I will turn every complaint into a blessing or a constructive suggestion and punt the pickle. And these are permanent professional artworks. Grinnell, Iowa, Grinnell Regional Medical Center. This is the first thing people say when they go to the patient accounting department. Penelope Pickle and the Pickle Pledge. Tell me, what do most people who are going to patient accounting have on their mind? Are they going to tell them what a great job it was? How happy they are? What are they usually going to do? Complain about their bill. They're not happy. And what they tell me is that simple act of putting that sign up there has had a big change in the attitude of people as they come up to the window. We are seeing people, as has happened here, bringing in pickle jars. And they fine each other. Every time you bitch, moan, whine, complain, gossip, point a finger, rumor monger, you got to put a quarter in the jar. And you see the quarters piling up and you say, I didn't think we were that negative. And the truth is, it's worse. You didn't catch them all. One day a guy came in and said, I know it's going to be a shitty day. Here's a buck. I'm paying in advance. What kind of a day do you think he ended up having? He ended up having a great day. Because instead of the old passive-aggressive thing, oh, Bob's having a bad day, stay away, they laughed about it. They talked about it. They raised their expectations of each other. He didn't get a refund, but he did have a great day. At Midland Memorial Hospital in West Texas, I challenged them. We did a culture assessment survey, and their results on that question for we treat others with respect and bring positive attitudes to work were about like what you saw. I challenged them. I said, if you can raise $1,000 in 1 week in quarters, 4,000 quarters, and put those quarters in pickle jars and donate that money to your employee assistance fund, then Values Coach will match it and we will write you a check for $1,000, a donation to your employee fund. And you should have seen the faces in the room. 4,000 times in 1 week? No way. I said, hey, I saw your culture survey. You guys could do this in 4 hours. So they had a pickle jar decorating contest like you did a couple years ago. That was one of my favorites, housekeeping. They had a jar decorated like a housekeeper. They had pickle eating contests in the cafeteria. They had pickle cupcakes. They were disgusting. This is their HR department. That wall is 25 feet long. And they hired a professional artist to come in and paint the pickle pledge on it. So anybody coming in to apply for a job, coming down to file a grievance, anybody going to HR for any reason, the first thing they see is, we're going to turn your complaint into a blessing or a constructive suggestion, but we're not going to sit around and whine about it. Excuse me. I was there when their accreditation surveyor showed up last August. Every single one of them commented on how much more positive the culture was than last time. And the nurse surveyor commented about all these pickle jars that are all over the place with the quarters in them. And she said, the highlight of my entire week is I heard a nurse say to a doctor, Doc, you're being a pickle. Put a quarter in the jar. They did. They raised their $1,000 with a lot of room to spare. We matched it. And it wasn't just the money donated to their fund. It was the impact they had on making people more aware of their own behaviors, their own attitudes. Caveat, anytime you take something like the pickle challenge, you're going to get resistance. And the most vigorous, vociferous resistance will be from who? The people who most need it. The people who are the biggest problem. The people who could most benefit from a change in attitude, but they got this little voice in the back of their head saying, this is stupid, I don't want to do this. And those people are always in denial. And part of the power of having to take a quarter out of your pocket is that it helps you break through that denial. One of the exercises I tell people to do, carry around a note card and a pen, and every time you catch yourself complaining, even if you're not saying it out loud, you're just thinking it, pull out your card and make a mark. I had to wait 20 minutes for my flight, and the coffee wasn't hot, and I have to sit here and listen to this boring speaker. That counts twice. And at the end of the week, pull out your card deck and count up all your marks. Multiply it by how long does the average gossip session, complaining, whining session last? 30 seconds, a minute, 2 minutes? I was at a hospital once where someone said, in this place, about 8 hours. Multiply it out, and that is how much of your life you wasted. Because anytime you're complaining, whether it's mental or out loud, anytime you're whining and complaining, you cannot be thinking of anything else. So one time I was talking about this, young man raised his hand. He said, Mr. Ty, what happened when you did the exercise? And I said, well, I wrote it. I don't need to do it. Don't you hate it when people do that? He was right, and I promised I would do it. You know how long I lasted? Not even a day. Before the end of the day, I had so many marks on my card, I knew what the end of the week would be. And that was like that whack in the side of the head that I myself started getting a whole lot more aware of my own negative thinking, my own whining and complaining. And so I have a challenge for you. Charlie doesn't think you can meet the challenge for different reasons than I usually hear. I told Charlie this morning I was going to give you this challenge. He said, oh no, we're so positive, we don't complain anymore. We'd never raise any money. My challenge to you, and I'm not sure you can make it either, but it's been a couple of years. My challenge to you is to pick a 1 week period, sometime in the fall, raise $500 in quarters. That's 2,500 quarters. By every time you catch yourself complaining, out loud or mentally, every time you catch somebody else complaining about something, say, invite them to put a quarter in the jar. Keep it nice, keep it positive, keep it lighthearted and fun. If you will raise $500 in 1 week in quarters and donate that money, I understand you're just starting an employee assistance fund. Donate that money to your employee assistance fund, all those quarters, then Values Coach will match it. And we'll write you a check for $500 for that fund. I'm excited about this because I think it's going to be a great experiment. Most places I go to, the reason they say we can't do it is we're so negative, we don't want to do it. I think you're going to have a really hard time because I think you probably are one of the most positive hospitals we work with. I also think you're wearing rose-colored glasses if you don't think that 2,500 times in a week somebody's complaining. In fact, I think you could raise $500 in a day if you were really being honest with yourself. But we'll see. Are you up for it? Are you up for that challenge? Okay. So, by the way, Eli, before you take off, I would love to get a picture of you and me. The Values Brothers. I'm not done yet. I got a few more things I want to cover. Actually, everybody close your eyes for 1 minute, please. Where was I? There we go. All right. You all know the self-empowerment pledge, and the most important three words in the Florence book are proceed until apprehended. You all know these promises by heart. I want to remind you why this works and how it works. Every day you're promising yourself to be responsible, accountable, determined, resilient, positive, and every day you catch yourself whining, complaining, making excuses, blaming other people, pointing fingers, and you get what psychologists call cognitive dissonance. Trying to hold two incompatible thoughts simultaneously. That is a form of mental illness, as you know. And at that point, like as I was saying, I'm responsible, accountable, and determined, but it's not my fault. Someone else is doing it. Poor me. Wah, wah, wah. And at that point, one of three things must happen because the cognitive dissonance, the pain becomes so great. One, you could decide this mental illness thing is not so bad after all. I'm okay with it. I'll keep making the promises, keep breaking them, and I'm okay with that. Or you stop making the promises, not because you don't have enough time. It's easy. If you keep making the promises, you must begin changing your thinking, your attitudes, your habits, your behaviors, and then you start getting out of debt, losing weight, starting to write the book you've always said you're going to write. And as you start to see the benefits, and so that's happened for some of you, it becomes more and more just a part of your DNA. And so I want to wrap up and tell you about three people. This is Katie Longbotham. Katie is the director of the endoscopy unit at Midland Memorial Hospital in West Texas. She had the courage, and it does take courage, to call all of her people together and say, we are going to do this promise together as a group every day. And you know there were people rolling their eyes. This is kindergarten stuff. This is silly. Why do I have to do that? One of the people doing that was Kyle Graham, a registered nurse on that unit. And she said, I can't make you feel the promises, but I can make you say the words. And he did. And every day he made the promise, he knew he was lying to himself. I will take complete responsibility for my health and happiness, knowing that he wasn't doing it. I will not allow low self-esteem and self-limiting beliefs, knowing that he was doing that every day. I'll do the things I'm afraid to do and ask for help when I need it, knowing that he hadn't been and he wasn't going to. How did he know he was lying? Because before the end of his shift, he was going to sneak into the medication room and steal narcotics for his own personal use because he's a drug addict. And nobody knew. And he said, the gap between the words I was saying and what I was seeing myself doing got bigger and bigger, and I finally just couldn't live with myself. He went home, he talked to his wife. They made an appointment to see Bob Dent, the CNO, now COO of the hospital. He admitted what he was doing. To the eternal credit of Midland Memorial Hospital, instead of having him arrested and fired, they could have. They sent him to a drug treatment program for 30 days. Kyle Graham is now coming up on almost 2 years of being clean and sober. And 2 weeks ago, the newest Chicken Soup for the Nurse's Soul came out with 100 stories in it. And one of them is the story of Kyle Graham and how, because he took to heart the self-empowerment pledge, what do you think was the word he used to describe the gift of sobriety that he has gained? Miracle was the word he used. If we each do our part, we can change our lives for the better, the way Kyle did. If we all do our part, we can change our organizations for the better. And in doing that, we can maybe change the world. Now I want to wrap up with one last thing. I want to introduce you to the person that you once were. Would you like to meet that person? That was once you. You found joy in everything you did. You could find laughter. You laughed 400, 500 times a day. That was once you. Everything was delightful. Everything was delicious. That was you. That was once you. You were curious about everything. That you wanted to know why. There was no such thing as a dumb question. You didn't let fear stop you from sticking your fingers in things and being out exploring. You had the insatiable curiosity of the elephant's child. That was you at one time. That was once you. You wanted to see everything from a different perspective. That was once you. You weren't afraid of falling down. You got right back up with a laugh and a smile and you tried again. That was once you. That was once you. You didn't have enemies. You saw a potential friend in everybody. And they saw a friend in you as a result. That was once you. You didn't worry about what you looked at like in a bathing suit stop you from going to the beach. That was once you. Nothing stopped you. When you were determined to do something, by golly, you did it and nothing got in your way. That was once you. You really liked the person you saw when you looked in the mirror. You liked that person looking back at you, and that person caused you to smile. That was once you. You looked at the road in front of you, the road of life, and instead of being frightened and anxious and uncertain, you saw this incredible adventure, and you couldn't wait to take the first step. That was once you. That was once you. You had this wide-eyed wonder at the glory, the miracle of life. And this joy that nobody could take away from you. That was once you. Wouldn't it be nice to become that you again? And the six things that I talked about today, that'll help you do that. That'll help you remember who you once were, reclaim, re-spark, and revitalize the dreams you once had. Thank you all very much for being who you are and for being here today. Can I ask for one volunteer to get a picture of Eli and me with your magnificent coat? Can you? Good grief. There we go.
We're going to be able to have rose colored glasses too.
Yep. And can you do one of each with my camera? Yeah.
This one first.
Yeah.
All right, yours is just this round button right there.
I think so.
Okay.
All right. The values, brothers. I'm not sure that's a good idea.
Did you get it?
No.
While you're doing that, I'd like to get one more, but let's get one of these slides in the background. Up, up, wait. I want to be in here.